Good morning, everyone. Thanks so much for coming. I'm Tom Bollyky. I'm the director of the Global Health Program at the Council on Foreign Relations. It's my great pleasure to welcome you to this conversation with Dr. John Nkengasong. We're extremely fortunate to have John here. So thank you so much for coming. John has deep experience with the threats, platforms, and programs that have defined the last two decades of global health. John has been is a leading virologist with over 30 years of experience in public health, much of it spent working on HIV, AIDS, and TB. He was chief of virology in Cote d'Ivoire for the US CDC for years, and then the former deputy principal director of the CDC's Center for Global Health. He is also, I should acknowledge, President Biden's nominee to serve as the U.S. Global AIDS Coordinator to lead the President's Emergency Program for AIDS Relief, the PEPFAR program, the flagship U.S. Global Health Program. John was born in Cameroon, and if confirmed, he would be the first person of African origin to lead the PEPFAR program, which is quite a step given that two-thirds of the world's population that is living with HIV/AIDS resides on the continent of Africa. But John also has deep experience with the threats, platforms, and programs that may define the next 20 years of global health. Since 2017, John has been the founding director of the Africa Center, Centers for Disease Control and Prevention, and has been marshaling the response around the continent to the COVID-19 pandemic, of course, working with national institutes of public health and ministers of health in the AU. He has been vocal in his current role in pushing for leaders on the African continent to assert what they want from global health programs and pushing for more regional capacity to produce supplies of diagnostics, vaccines, therapeutics, and to build the workforce to confront future global health threats. Regional approaches such as those occurring through the African CDC have gotten more attention as the global response to COVID-19 has been slow and in some areas like vaccine equity faltering. So if you wanted to have a conversation about the once and future role of global health programs and platforms, we can really do no better than to speak to John. And we will be talking today about the current state of the COVID response in the African region, as well as future possibilities of integrating pandemic preparedness and response into broader global health architecture. I want to make a couple of caveats here. John, we're having some technical difficulties, so I'm sorry to say John will be just speaking verbally. His video is turned off to preserve the strength of the connection. So I apologize for that. John also, because he is his nomination is before the U.S. Senate, we're going to be talking more broadly about the global health programs and how to integrate programs. But he'll obviously be a little restrained in terms of his ability to comment on PEPFAR in particular in this context. This conversation today is for attribution. So please keep that in mind. And with that, I'm going to ask John a few questions to start us off. We'll speak for about 20 or 30 minutes, and then we will turn it over to the audience. And when I call on you, if you'll state your name and affiliation and make your question please sound like a question. And with that, I'll start with John. And John, I'd be grateful for your, we'd all be grateful for your current update on the state of the pandemic in the African region. Where you see, what will 2022 bring for the continent with regard to this pandemic and its broader health effects?
Thank you so much, Thomas, for inviting me again to be a part of this conversation, which I'm delighted to contribute. I must say that the continent of Africa, from where I sit, we have been fighting COVID now collectively for the past close to 24 months. I would characterize the situation as pretty uncertain, with a trajectory that is unpredictable. And for reasons that I'm sure we'll discuss subsequently, mainly due to the limited access to vaccines. As we speak today, as a continent of 1.2 billion people, about 8.5 million cases of COVID-19 have been reported from 55 member states. And of that, about 220,000 people have died. And the continent has gone through third waves. And what is interesting with these waves, as in other parts of the world, is that the peak of the third wave is, of course, was significantly higher than the peak of the second wave, and the peak of the second wave was significantly higher than the peak of the first wave. During the first wave, it was almost which peak around July of last year. It was almost difficult to find somebody who knew somebody who had died of AIDS in Africa. But today, it is very common to see somebody who knows somebody whose family, loved ones, or relatives have died of COVID. Just to say that during the last 2.5 months, where the continent experienced a very brutal third wave, about 40% of the new infections occurred just during the last week. It just shows you the brutality and aggressivity of when these waves come in. So I think that is where the continent is. It's the continent where it's challenged. The number that is the 8.5 million cases are indicated should be considered as underestimate, because we now have evidence, serologic evidence, that shows that far more people have been exposed to the COVID-19 virus than the numbers that have been reported. But that is the state of where we are today with the pandemic.
Great. Thank you so much. Two-part question here on the state of the pandemic on the continent. So I think many in the early days of the pandemic were expecting, of course, considerably worse outcomes on the African continent. And many have been more pleasantly surprised by how countries have done, even with the escalating waves you reference. And I wonder now, being 21 months into this pandemic, what you attribute that success to. That's the first part. And the second part, I would just want you to comment on the role of the African CDC. This is a relatively new platform, started in 2017. How has that helped make a difference in this pandemic?
Thank you, Thomas. I think there are several factors that have contributed to the state of the pandemic in Africa the way it is. I think, first of all, I was very deliberate in highlighting that the number of cases that are reported, that is the 8.5 million confirmed cases by molecular testing, are actually a significant underestimate. However, the number of deaths is amazingly still, I think even if we double the number of deaths, that is the 220,000 deaths on the continent of 1.2 million, or triple that, it is still, it doesn't still reflect the projections that we, that some modelers had for at the beginning of the pandemic. That is certain, because we don't see large grave or massive barriers as we saw in May in India, right? You can't hide those things. When it's happening, you know it. You see it. During the third week, we saw some of that, but it was not as brutal as what we saw in India. So that is what we call the puzzle of COVID-19 in Africa. That is, the large number of people that have been infected, but relatively low rate. Unfortunately, we begin to characterize 220 reported deaths like a low rate, which is really unfortunate for an issue like human life really matters, truly matters. However, so what are some of the factors that we believe are contributing or have contributed to this? First of all, I think strongly that the strong political leadership and of the continent has played a role. If you look at the evolution of this virus, by January 20th of 2020, about four countries had reported COVID-19. By 15th of February, the first case was identified in Egypt. 15th of February. And 1 week later, the African CDC and the African Union convened a meeting of ministers of health, all ministers of health. I was surprised that within 1 week, we were able to gather 40 of the 55 ministers of health in Addis Ababa. Even ministers that were traveling rerouted from Europe and attended the meeting in Addis Ababa. I think we were pleasantly surprised. It was one of those risky decisions that we took. We said, okay, if we were, and others actually opposed us. They said, well, if you call a meeting within 1 week and ministers don't come, you'll be a failure. But we were very pleasantly surprised that it was the first time in my 30 years experience that ministers have reacted that way. When they left the meeting, on the 22nd of February, there was a common understanding of action. And they also agreed on a joint continental strategy that was underpinned by the need to cooperate, collaborate, communicate, and coordinate efforts. I think that was central. I'm pleased to know that Jay Verma is on this platform because he was here at CDC at that time, and we jointly developed that joint continental strategy and literally solely to the ministers who came there. So that political leadership should always be remembered, because when the first cases started showing up in countries, they did exactly that, what we did. I think countries went into lockdown with two cases reported. Countries declared state of emergency. So that period allowed the continent to mobilize, because there were no diagnostics, absolutely no diagnostics in January, regardless of which country you were in, whether you were in Morocco or South Africa. There were no personal protective equipment. So by doing those kind of actions, they will blunt at least the first waves of the spread of the pandemic. The second thing we believe has contributed extensively for the population, the structure of the population. You know, the median age of the continent is around 20 years. And we early on, of course, when we our understanding of the virus continues to improve. But early on, we know that younger people on the continent were infected, but they were not. They were made largely asymptomatic. And I think we have seen that even within the Africa CDC context, where large number of staff were infected, young people, but they were not sick. So I think that is also a factor that must be considered. And lastly is what I call the unknown, and which I think only research, continuous research, will continue to guide us on what some of the factors are that have contributed to this. But that situation is changing, though, because with the new variant, we are beginning to see younger people fall sick and actually die of the virus. So I think that is why I started off by saying that the trajectory is uncertain and unpredictable on the continent.
Great. Thank you for that. You did reference the vaccine situation and the lack of access on the continent. And I did want to throw out some statistics for the audience so they can appreciate what the current challenge is. According to date, just 209 million doses have been administered across the continent of Africa, which is less than 3% of all COVID vaccine shots administered worldwide. Half of those doses within the continent have just gone to three countries, so Egypt, Morocco, and South Africa. To appreciate how great the disparity is, a greater percentage of Britons have received their third dose than the percentage of people living on the continent of Africa have received their first dose from this crisis. We are starting to administer doses to small children in the U.S. Other countries are going to follow suit. Before, there are countries on the continent that have received sufficient doses to vaccinate all their health workers and high-risk elderly. So it is pretty stark, the inequity. And I want to hear from you, John, what you see as the shorter, the medium, and the longer term solutions to the kind of inequity we've seen in this crisis. Where what will change between what needs to change between now and next September, where we have a global goal of 70% of the world countries being 70% vaccinated, all countries. What needs to change to make that happen? And looking towards the future, what do we need to do to make sure this kind of stark inequity doesn't happen again?
Thank you so much. I think your statistics on vaccinated population on the continent is accurate. As we speak today, the continent of 1.2 billion have received 357 million doses of vaccine. I've administered 209 million doses, and also those who are partially vaccinated, the percentage is 9%, and fully vaccinated is 6% of 1.2 billion people. So I think we have a long way to go to get to 70%. The continent has a challenge. And again, that is why I started this conversation by referring to the unpredictability and the uncertain trajectory of the pandemic. Now, the COVID-19 has taught us as a whole, as humanity, three key things. The one, that the depth of inequality or inequities that we thought existed and we knew existed is more profound. And even within Africa, you cited some, I mean, with some numbers, that Morocco has vaccinated close to 60% of its eligible population, whereas countries like the DR Congo, Democratic Republic of Congo, they have vaccinated less than 0.1% of its entire population, a country of 100 million people. And we see that between regions and, of course, within countries. The second thing I've always said is vulnerability, that vulnerabilities are more deeper than we thought. And then, of course, the connectivity, that within 2 months or so, the virus could circulate, I mean, very, very widely. All of these, the three components, that, i.e. the connectivity, vulnerability and inequities and inequalities all play, speak to the need to have rapid access to vaccines and scale up of vaccines. I must say that the situation is improving because supplies are coming in now, especially bilateral donations of the 209 million doses of vaccines that have been administered. Or rather, let's use 357 million, more than 70 million have been donations from the United States government. And that represents about 20% of the overall supply for the continent, which is the largest supply. And recently, the U.S. Government was ready to trade in their contracts with Moderna for the continent to acquire an additional 100 million doses of vaccine from Moderna. And we are very grateful for that. The continent as a whole is extremely grateful for that. Now, there's also inequities in the distribution of vaccines. We find, as a continent, Africa finds itself in a place where I'm now concerned that as more vaccines come in, vaccination becomes a challenge. Not because people don't want to take it, but because of the logistics of storage, transportation, distribution, immunization. So, this is an appeal for more partnerships. This is an appeal for more cooperation. This is an appeal for more solidarity to look at the both sides of vaccine, the vaccine plus vaccination, so that we can actually collectively get to 70%, which is a need and a collective a desire for the entire world, not just for Africa, because as we all know, none of us will be safe until all of us are safe. Way the variants are emerging, we just don't know. Today we all talk about the Delta variant, but without vaccinating quickly and without vaccinating at scale, we will all continue to be under severe threat.
Great. So that's really helpful. Thank you, John. In terms of what needs to happen, though, to make that occur, is it a matter of ramping up production, sharing more supplies? Do we have the investments and programs in place to build up the distribution, storage, and immunization capacity that you referenced to? What is the current state of those investments being lined up to make this happen by next September? And where do we see those investments coming from? From where will we get those vaccines? From where will we get those investments in distribution and immunization programs?
So there are four things, Thomas, that I believe should happen and happen simultaneously to enable the continent to move from Bollyky, that is a 6% who is vaccinated to 70%. One is the continuous sharing of doses. The examples I cited for the United States is something that other countries should follow through. I mean, and actually, the definition of health diplomacy should be the ability for the continent, I believe, should be the ability to partner with it to get it to 70% and not do little distributions like 100,000 doses here and there. I mean, that is not going to help. I mean, the kind of bold example and initiative and leadership that the United States government has exercised is what I will call on other countries to follow. The second thing is contracts, where the continent, as we speak, is not necessarily saying we should all rely on sharing, but contracts that they can buy into. Because, I mean, the 400 million doses of vaccines that the African Vaccine Acquisition Task Team acquired was acquired with funding from ministries of finance, that is, and through the support of the World Bank in some cases. So I think if contracts were shifted, then the continent can get into acquiring some vaccines. A good example is what I mentioned, the Moderna contract that the U.S. That worked out with the African Union to enable it move its own supplies faster. Thirdly is the issue of manufacturing. We as the African CDC, we recognized the problem early on that manufacturing was very limited. We actually, as a continent, noticed that only 1% of vaccines were produced on the continent, not COVID vaccines, but all kinds of vaccines, and 99% imported. So we hosted a summit on the 12th and 13th of April, a high-level meeting where head of states were present, and the commitment is huge. I mean, we now have about 10 countries that have now said where we are interested in vaccine manufacturing. The Rwandas, the Kenyas, the Senegal, South Africa, Morocco, Egypt, they're all into vaccine manufacturing now. And I just came back from Senegal last week, and I was very pleased to see the massive investment that is going on in Senegal by the Pasteur Institute to build a vaccine manufacturing site. And they hope that by the next 8 months, they'll begin to produce vaccines. We know that Rwanda, BioNTech has just signed an agreement with South Africa, Rwanda and Senegal to produce more vaccines, and there's a vaccine hub that has been set up in South Africa. So I remain optimistic that by the end of next year, they will begin to see different dynamics on vaccine on the continent. So, and lastly, is the distribution of the vaccines. Very, very important. We should build the right partnerships to accelerate the delivery of vaccines from the airport to the arm. Extremely important. Otherwise, we may find ourselves as the world, in a situation where the vaccines are beginning to be available and we have challenges in uptake of the vaccine.
Great. Thank you, John. That's very helpful. I wanted to now pivot to talking about a bit about the lessons, building on the theme of the once and future role of global health programs and platforms. We've been talking about local ownership for a long time in global health, and yet many of the challenges around capacity they've described on the manufacturing side have gone unmet. While I do see the role of the African CDC and some of the programs we've managed to build around public health in country as being a good example of some of those investments in local ownership. Now, having had this experience of the pandemic, I want you to think about a little bit in the future what this means for our global health programs. How do they incorporate these lessons moving forward? Obviously, there will be a premium on global health security. How do programs, even those that are not dedicated specifically to that, integrate to this increased intention of trying to reduce the threat of future pandemics?
Oh, great. I think that is a subject that I have been reflecting a lot on and drawing lessons from the past close to 21 months of this pandemic. And there are six key lessons that have emerged, at least from where I sit. with respect to the pandemic. And I think that they are centered around what I call the lessons I've learned from this pandemic, centered around what I call the four P's of the pandemic. That is, understand the pathogen, understand the population, understand the policies, and understand the politics. If these are the four P's that will govern the six lessons that I have learned from it. So first is political leadership. That regardless of what we do today, in preparation for tomorrow, we have to be sure, make sure that the political leadership take control of the pandemic. That has been lesson number one for Africa CDC. Africa CDC was only 3 years old when this pandemic hit, exactly 3 years old. And we've spent the rest of the 2 years into this pandemic. And the only reason that it has played a critical role in coordinating the response is because it received a strong political ownership and support of the head of state. The head of state has convened Africa CDC 16 times, and the bureau meeting and said, tell us where this pandemic is going, what must we do together, and they do keep doing that almost every month, and have been doing that consistently. So that is important lesson to learn for pandemics, because pandemics, when they hit, as we all have learned, is no longer a health issue, it's truly a security issue, and I would even take it further to say that it is a national security issue and an economic issue, so that you elevate it to the level of the head of state. Lesson number two is, I've learned from this, is that you prepare your health system before you need them. You don't need them when you are in the pandemic. You don't build them when you are in the pandemic. I mean, absolutely difficult to do that. And the role of National Public Health Institute, we should look at our health security going forward in three layers. The national structures, that is the National Public Health Institute, the regional bodies like the Africa CDC of the world, and of course, the global level, the WHOs and others of the world. And all three must be looked at collectively, not separately, so that the conversation is more holistic. I think we've seen in this pandemic that countries that have functional and strong national public health institutes were easy. It was easy to coordinate a response with those countries, like the likes of Nigeria CDC, where Chikwe was outstanding in leading the response in Nigeria, and the Ethiopian Public Health Institute and others. Thirdly is what I call the power of regionalism. We have to and must promote regional efforts. And I'm very pleased that regions like the Gulf States, ASEANs are thinking of developing a similar model like the Africa CDC. I've been receiving many calls from those regions there because they play a critical role. If we have to strengthen our global health security architecture, the regional bodies must be both strengthened and empowered. Fourthly is manufacturing of health security commodities, i.e. diagnostics, vaccines, and therapeutics. When the conversation today is so much focused on vaccines, but remember, 20 months ago, it was on diagnostics, it was on access to diagnostics. Even if countries in Africa had the money, they didn't know where to go get the diagnostics. And for close to 40 years, we've been conducting mass HIV testing on the continent, but there is absolutely no one country that produced a simple rapid test for HIV, okay, on the continent. So why is that important? If countries were producing that and then you have a disease emerge, you can actually repurpose that technology, that know-how, and produce similar diagnostics, right? So that you don't have that. Now that you see Morocco and Senegal are beginning to produce COVID-related diagnostics, but that is something that should be promoted in a very deliberate fashion. We've discussed vaccines, so I will not touch on that. I mean, there's a big movement on the continent to produce vaccines, but other commodities as well. Fifthly is workforce development. Workforce development, we, in April of last year, we were able to go to the African Union Peace and Security Council, convince them and give us the authorization as Africa CDC to hire a military plane, take it to DRC to transport responders to Burkina Faso, Mali, and Niger. Okay, so we had to work with them to harness all the assets of the African Union to deploy even responders across. And at that time, no planes were flying on the continent, none. So the only planes flying at night were the military planes that were piloting to drop responders across the continent. Lastly is impactful partnership. It's a partnership, the kind of partnership that I just with a partnership that listens to where the continent's needs are and meet them at their point of need is extremely important. I mean, i.e. the donations for vaccines that the United States have made available, using their contract to meet them at the point of need is extremely valuable. The kind of partnership that the MasterCard Foundation has brought forward, they have allocated $1.5 billion to Africa's CDC to support vaccine acquisition, to support vaccination, to support vaccine manufacturing, and to support Africa's CDC's own capacity. I think those are the six emerging lessons that I'm sure by the end of this pandemic, maybe, who knows when, more lessons would have been learned, but I think those are the six that have emerged from where I sit.
Great. Thank you, John. Those are really well-made points. I wanted to ask one question, and then I'll turn it over to the audience. So start thinking about your questions. I will call you in the order that I see your hands. The last question I just wanted to ask before turning it over to the audience, John, is that what practical signs do you see on the six-part agenda that you've just laid out? What practical signs do you see that we will be safer, better prepared next time around? What are you seeing in these areas, any of them, that you would point to that are clear signs that in peacetime we'll start to adopt these lessons so that when the next crisis emerges, we'll be ready to respond to it?
Absolutely. I remain optimistic that access to vaccines and diagnostics that will be improved the next time, because the efforts that the continent has engaged itself, the journey of producing vaccines, if done right and if done in a coordinated fashion, it will begin to shift the paradigm significantly. I think that I'm very encouraged with that. I'm very encouraged that countries like Morocco, South Africa, Senegal that are producing diagnostics now, will establish the know-how in the manner that when a new pathogen is emerged and we know the sequences, they can easily produce a diagnostic. Right? I think we knew the sequences of this virus around the 10 or 12 of January, so that it was a question of putting a bright mind together to do that. And I really hope that the political leadership will be sustained and those some of the regional architectures that were put in place, and maybe this is the point to list some of them. It is for our collective interest that mechanisms like the African Vaccine Acquisition Task Team, which has offered a platform to distribute vaccines now across the continent, are sustained so that we can use them for distributing other vaccines and not just COVID vaccines in future. It's for our common interest that a platform like the African Medicine Supply Platform, which you can Google, you can type in on your phone, AMSP.Africa, which produces a platform like Amazon.com, and any country in Africa can go in and shop for the response commodities. That such platforms will be sustained and maintained and be used for other to fight other diseases. So those are some of the platforms, just to limit myself to them, that offer an opportunity to fight pandemics in future, regardless of where they're coming from.
Great. Thanks, John. Those are good things to point to for having some optimism at a moment that for I think many doesn't necessarily afford much of it. Let me turn it over to the audience. And again, I will call you in the order that I've seen you. Please press the raise hand icon if you'd like to ask a question. I'm going to start with Craig Charney. And then we'll go to Mitchell and Ryan. If you could just state your name and your affiliation, and again, phrase the question as a question. Thank you.
Thanks. I'm Craig Charney of Charney Research. We've worked with Resolve to Save Lives in Nigeria and IREX in Nicaragua on COVID issues. My question is this. Jennifer Nuzzo, in an earlier CFR meeting, said that the IMF had done a study and suggested that the whole world could be vaccinated for about $50 billion. Wouldn't it make sense for the U.S. either to create a PEPFAR-like program to do that, given the slowness with which contributions are being made to COVAX, or simply to give enough money to close the gap to COVAX and say, go to it. At a time when we're passing trillion-dollar bills, it seems to me that this would be almost trivial sum, yet one with huge benefits.
John, would you like to take that about?
I'll just follow your lead. If you want me to do the quick one question after another, I'll do that. So I think that there is, I'm encouraged that there's a collective political drive to act quickly. And some examples include the recent summit that President Biden hosted just a few weeks ago on COVID, and which brought leaders across the whole world together to begin to discuss ways that they can be tackled. And we now know that just yesterday, I believe, Secretary Blinken hosted a meeting with foreign ministers across the world to discuss ways that can be we can work collectively. The key word is collectively to address this very important challenge of our time. And that is the kind of leadership that we believe is required to bring this pandemic to an end. Because we are in the second year, could hardly imagine last year that we will be almost two years into this pandemic. But I'm encouraged that that kind of bold leadership, like the one I just described, is emerging. We also now know that the UN Secretary General has called for a strong collective global action on that. So I think those are the kind of bold initiatives that we need to carry forward. Yes, we need money to do this, and need money to do it quickly. I'm also encouraged that there's a discussion led by the White House on the financial intermediate fund that could be used for overall pandemic response going forward.
Great, thank you, John. We have six questions, so I think we still have time to take them one by one. But if that changes, I'm happy to take them in groups. So don't be shy by the size of the list. I will find a way to get you all in there. Why don't we go next to Mitchell?
Great, thank you so much, Tom, and great to see you, and John, great to hear you, and hope to see you sometime soon. You did a beautiful job describing both the work of the Africa CDC in the COVID response and laying out a great vision for preparedness of the future, which is spot on. I'm wondering if you could comment at all on the ongoing issues and how we protect the previous gains in the TB response, HIV response, childhood immunization, contraceptive supplies. And just wondering your sense on the continent of what's slipped back and how might we get back on track with any or all of those huge health needs in the midst of a pandemic and preparing for the future to protect those gains on an ongoing basis.
Thanks, Michelle. Good to hear you. I was hoping to see you, and I'm sure you were hoping to see me on camera, but the technology is not always predictable. I think there are three parts to your question. One is that we really have to step back and look at the continent from its population. I said earlier that there are usually four P's that guide my thinking on pandemic. That is, again, the pathogen, the population, the policies, and the politics. If you look at the population of Africa, the continent is at a point where in the next 30 years, the population is projected to get double, about 2.4 billion people. And whereas other populations of countries like India, China, and Europe will be plateauing there. And that is very important. The shift in rural population versus urban population is also important. From that perspective, from a pathogen perspective now, there are three pockets of things we are looking at very carefully. One are the emerging and re-emerging diseases that are becoming very disruptive. I've been in this job for 5 years and been to DRC there four times, and in all visits there, I've not talked of endemic diseases. I've rather talked of emerging diseases, whether it's Ebola or a large-scale outbreak of measles there. So, and that is going to challenge seriously the already endemic diseases and pandemics. We should always remember that HIV is still a pandemic in Africa. It depends on how you characterize a pandemic there. I always say that, forced to say that there are two types of pandemic. There's a silent pandemic like HIV, and then there's a disruptive pandemic like the COVID. But that brings me to the second pocket of this disease, is that we have made tremendous gains in their control, and lastly, due to the United States leadership in, be it in the TB programs or the malaria programs or HIV programs. So we have to look at this now in a more holistic manner, and otherwise it will be disruptive. I mean, the disruptive pandemics will emerge, or outbreaks will emerge, and then completely force us to stop what we are doing with those endemic diseases and focus energy and resources to the emerging diseases. And lastly, are the non-communicable diseases and the injuries. I think those are three pockets there. But the third part of this is that there are commonalities. Okay, there are common areas that we really have to look at. We cannot look at each in isolation. We should be looking at institution strengthening. We should be looking at workforce. We should be looking at manufacturing. We should be looking at regulatory issues for either diagnostics, vaccines, or therapeutics. And very importantly, is access to predictable access to financing, including, and very importantly, and I underline that, domestic financing. So that, I mean, there should be, country should be taking leadership, ownership of some of these responsibilities, and importantly, and lastly, partnership. If this is the interface of the three pockets, whether you are dealing with emerging and re-emerging infectious disease or endemic diseases slash endemic pandemics, if I can use the word, and the rising tides of non-communicable diseases, those are the areas of focus that we have to keep an eye on.
Great. Thank you, John. We're going to start taking questions in groups of two so we can make sure we get through all of them. So, John, if you'll wait for the second question to answer. We're going to go to Ryan, and then we're going to go to Shannon. Ryan?
Yeah, thank you, Tom. Thank you, Tom, and greetings, John. This is Ryan Moorhard with Ginkgo Bioworks, and thanks for spending time with us today. I just wondered if you could share with us a little bit your perspective as the leader of an organization, and just reflecting on how quickly you've grown the team there at Africa CDC and across the continent, and just how capable that team has been over the course of the response. It's just been really incredible, and wonder if you could share some wisdom with us. Thank you, John.
Thank you, Ryan. I'm good to
John, I'm just going to let Shannon ask her question too to make sure we have time for everyone. Sorry about that. Shannon?
Thank you so much. Thank you, Dr. Nkengasong, for taking time with us today. I'm Shannon Kelman. I'm the policy director at Friends of the Global Fight. And I was hoping to ask you, the U.S. announced on Wednesday that it would host the next replenishment for the Global Fund to fight AIDS, TB, and malaria. Obviously, understanding you can't go into terribly much detail given your confirmation process, but what policy proposals would you like to see come out of the next replenishment, not just the funding, but how would you like to see programming adapt for the next 3 years of the fight against infectious diseases, including in that how we bring this pandemic to an end and how we think forward on the future pandemic response?
Thank you. Thomas, can I take the two now?
Yes, you may. Thank you.
Starting with Ryan, your question on what the growth and Africa CDC and what we learned, I think perhaps the most important lesson I've learned from the Africa CDC developing, setting up a new organization from scratch is really support from your friends. I think it's support from your friends. Calling you to say that we know it's difficult, but hang out there is extremely important. Because, I mean, when Ryan, you remember I was on my way to taking this job, and you and I met at Davos, and we sat down, maybe that was in the parking lot of one market, and started discussing partnerships and collaboration. And you stayed faithful. You remain faithful. You check on me every time, and I made sure you facilitated events where Africa CDC presented its vision. And that is very important. I think when people talk of partnership, especially when Africa is concerned, it's not necessarily monetary partnership. It's a partnership that says that I hear you, opposed a little bit to listen to you. I hear the vision, I'll support that vision. And that's exactly what people like you did. And it was extremely important. It was a huge moral investment that contributed tremendously in the same power. The same power that says that when the going was tough, you just remember that you have friends out there and partners that are committed and want to see you succeed. So I think that is a key thing. If any, you see any friend out there who wants to start up the Gulf CDC or the ASEAN CDC, tell them to rely on their friends, that they are committed to giving a good word about them and facilitating access to important conversations. With respect to the announcement, I haven't seen it, Shannon, but I must say that the Global Fund has just begun. From the perspective of not knowing what the announcement says, is that it, to me, is the greatest expression of the human solidarity that I can recall in my 30 years of experience, where the world came together and said, we have a moral issue here to address, which is HIV/AIDS, and we have to address it fairly. And it became a game changer with other initiatives, bilateral initiatives like TEPFA. So I think I would just hope that that kind of global cooperation and solidarity continues to be there.
Great. Thank you, John. We have three questions left and 9 minutes to do that. So we'll take two and then move to the third one. And then if there's anybody else who'd like to have a question, I think we can probably fit in one more as that part of group of that second two, if you'd like. But why don't we start now with Rajiv and then Emmanuel.
Thanks, Tom, and great to hear you, John. I'm Rajiv Enkai with Takeda, but I also have the pleasure of serving with John on the boards of CEPI and IAVI. John, there was some great news about the Africa Medicines Agency establishment recently. Didn't receive a lot of press, but it would be great to hear your thoughts on what can be done to stand that up as rapidly as possible, given your experience in building regional capabilities and organizations? And do you see an opportunity to bring that together with the initiative to establish regional manufacturing capacity for vaccines and medicines as a way to perhaps spur that forward?
Great questions. Emmanuel?
Please accept.
Hi, sorry for the delay. Thank you, Dr. Nkengasong, for taking the time to speak to us. My question is a little different, and it's to ask whether in your present position, you've seen a big gap between what outside donors' priorities are and what those of the Africa CDC, but also governments and communities in Africa are, whether it comes to COVID or other issues. Thank you.
Great. Emmanuel, do you just want to introduce yourself so that sure. John knows who you are.
Yes, so I'm Emmanuel Darcourt. I'm the Chief Program and Innovation Officer at Helen Keller International, which works a lot, particularly in West Africa. Thank you.
Great. John?
Thank you. I think that is good to see you, or good to hear your voice. And there are two things concerning the African Medicine Agency that I've been talking to Michelle Sidibe that you all know, and also the folks driving that agenda, that the moment is now for that new institution to actually also be supported significantly. And on a light note, let me say this before I continue my thinking there. You all have the responsibility not to give it time to rest. The same push, the pressure that you put on Africa CDC in just 2 years to stand up, you all have to do that to push AMA to stand up and do what he has to do. And the opportunity is now on a serious note, where the back many countries, as I said, about 10 countries in Africa are curious to and eager to develop a vaccine. The opportunity is huge because of the continental free trade area that already exists in Africa, which can actually help facilitate that. So just to give you an idea, on the 1st and 2nd of December, the Africa CDC will join forces with AMA and the continental free trade area and the the African Union Development Agency to hold a meeting in Kigali where the only topic there for discussion will be the regulatory pathways for vaccines approval on the continent. And that will be led by AMA, who will be behind supporting. So we are a baby, we are a baby that is walking already and can lend a hand and support another African Union baby and say, look, move up, go ahead, we are behind you. So I think it will be very exciting to see AMA begin to take center stage and address some of the issues related to vaccine manufacturing in Africa. So I think, as I said earlier on the line note, we are not giving them time to settle. We are going to put them under the baptism of fire very quickly to stand up and start running. I think that it counts on partnership. I think if I can appear on behalf of the African Medicine Agency, I would say the same kind of partnership and support that you all provided Africa CDC, please bring it to bear to support AMA. It is a collective public good for all of us. And second is the capacity. I mean, standing up capacity, and there are several ways people can contribute. You can second people to AMA to come support them, and many other ways to do that. The question Emmanuel raised about this alignment of funding or priorities is key. And I think misalignment doesn't, in my experience sitting here for the last 5 years, it doesn't occur because people are disrespectful of the continental priorities. I think there have been two things. One is it was no vehicle, no organization or institution that had the political ownership of the continent that could articulate their priorities for the continent. Now Africa CDC is doing that at least for 4 years. And you soon see that for AMA articulation, that way everybody has a common understanding of what is it that the priorities are for the continent. And if you have resources to support you, align along those lines. So I think I'm very encouraged to see these institutions beginning to emerge and lay out a vision for the continent. You hear more often the continent talk about a new public health order for the continent. A new public health order that says strengthening of institutions is important, manufacturing is important, workforce development is important, and domestic investment and action-oriented, respectful partnerships. I mean, that is the concept that build up the new public health order. And with that, we help align resources on the continent and ensure that there are greater synergies and efficiency.
Great. Thank you so much, John. We have 2 questions in 3 minutes, and if we keep them nice and short, I'm confident we can get through them. Dr. Johnson?
Thank you. I'm Lean Johnson, an independent consultant who works on African security issues. And I'm pleased to hear the report about the progress made with the African Medicines Agency. But I'd like to ask another question related to preparedness for future events. And that is, how can we get the level of political engagement that you saw at the beginning of COVID to address the strategic issue of the threat that public health challenges poses for security in Africa? That is, the African Union has asked all countries to prepare national security strategies. How can we be sure that the CDC, the African CDC, can serve as an expert advisor to provide information for framing the preparedness for these future events?
Great, thank you. Tammy Holtman?
Yes, thank you, Dr. Nkengasong. I'm Tammy Holtman from All Africa, and I would like for you to comment on the role of African media, beleaguered as it is, as most independent media around the world have been recently, what is the role of African media in public health education? What can it do? What should it be trying to do? And how important is that?
Great. 2 big questions to close this out, John.
2 big questions and 2 simple answers, I believe. I think the first one is on the political engagement. I'm very encouraged, with respect to the strong political leadership and engagement that I've seen emerge on the continent. I've never seen this, as I've said, in 30 years, and we are riding on that. President Ramaphosa is the COVID champion, and we are proposing, just completely to answer your question, proposing an African Preparedness and Response Authority we set up. That will be, and that will empower further Africa CDC to make to take decisions on cross-border issues for pandemic preparedness or anything that the region considers as a regional threat. So we'll see how far we go with that, but it's called APRA, the African Preparedness and Response Authority. With respect to media, Tammy, I'm very encouraged. I do media briefings every Thursday at 12 o'clock Ethiopian time. I'm very encouraged by the strong engagement and the role that the African media has played in several areas of this pandemic, in both moving on or transmitting public health messages, in areas of vaccine, addressing community engagement with vaccines, and telling the, or educating, informing the community. So I'm really, and we do that regularly. We've done that now for close to 2 years, and they are always present. And when I do the review of the literature, I'm very encouraged. Are there areas of gaps to improve? Yes, I think we should be more deliberate to include them in the public health response strategy, which I don't think we have had the time to do it, because we've literally, as Africa CDC, grew up in the pandemic, and we're, so you don't have time to stop and breathe. But when this pandemic is, allows us to stop and breathe, I think those are areas that we will be looking at. The media and behavioral scientists will be two key areas that we'd like to take a closer look at.
Great. Well, thank you so much, Dr. Nkengasong. Very thoughtful, as always. It's always a pleasure to host you here, and nice to hear from you. So we really appreciate you taking time out to speak with us today. Thank you to the audience for joining us, and we look forward to seeing you for our next roundtable. Thanks so much, John.
Thank you.